Hi guys, so to go ahead with the continuation of it, let's have a quick recap on what we discussed previous classes. So we saw how we constructed a decision tree, and after constructing the decision tree, we saw how the algorithm also works, right? Because we had a very good idea of how the decision tree is constructed, so we're able to correlate with respect to the algorithm. So after that, we saw about, what inductive bias are. So we saw the construction of the decision trees, and we saw how the inductive bias are. Okay, construction of the decision trees, like how exactly the search strategy is going to work ahead. So we saw that shorter trees are really very, very much considered comparatively to a longer trees, the first one. And the second one is the highest information gain is normally preferred to be very closer to the root node. Okay, so that was basically the preferences that was being given with respect to the decision tree. We also saw a few limitations of decision trees, few capabilities of decision trees were like decision trees, you know, like they were considering the noisy data as well, okay, by considering the error pruning or the rule post pruning. Okay, so they were able to consider even the noisy data or any error data that has been present. It was really able to handle that particular training examples. We also saw that certain limitations with respect to decision tree was there was no backtracking that was being available with respect to decision trees. Decision trees are very, very discrete, finite values that has been used for its construction. Okay, and apart when we look at it, comes up with only one instance hypothesis. Okay. Whereas candidate elimination algorithm used to have multiple hypothesis instances or spaces, you know, like, so, but the consistent hypothesis was only one with respect to decision trees, whereas in candidate elimination, you get multiple, a set of consistent hypothesis. So is it only one decision tree or is there any other consistent decision trees? These are all so many questions that was arising in our minds, right? Right. Okay. So going ahead with today's concept, you know, like what is bias? There are two things that we have to go here. Okay. One with respect to an ID3 and the candidate elimination algorithm, we see how things would go ahead. Okay. So when we consider ID3, okay, we call it to be as an inductive bias. Okay, inductive bias is solely a consequence of the ordering of hypothesis. Okay, so inductive bias is solely the consequence of ordering of the hypothesis. With candidate elimination algorithm, okay, we call that inductive bias is solely a sequence of the expressive power of its hypothesis. Why so? Because when we are creating the decision trees itself, as we told, it considers discrete valued functions, right, or the attributes. So in that case, when it starts constructing its root node, its decision, the branches, its decision nodes, its leaf node, you know, it comes up with one particular hypothesis that best fits the problem. Okay, whereas with respect to candidate elimination algorithm, it used to tell us something like, it comes up with, okay, we had the specific hypothesis, we had the generic hypothesis. The generic hypothesis used, it had certain set of instance spaces, okay, a set of instance spaces. So it's going to be an expressive power of its hypothesis, okay. So preference for certain hypothesis over others, okay. Preference for certain hypothesis over the others. There's an R missing if you do not mind. Okay. We normally call something with respect to this to be as a preference bias or a search bias. Whereas in candidate elimination algorithm, it is a categorical restriction on set of hypotheses. So we call it to be as a restriction bias or a language bias. So these are very, very concised, or it is very, very more specific with respect to the type of algorithm, okay, whether it is an ID3 algorithm or the candidate elimination algorithm. The ID3 algorithm, we normally call it to be as a preference bias, okay, or the search bias, because it's actually trying to search the entire decision tree, okay, Whereas here it is a categorical restriction on the set of hypotheses. As I told you, it is going to be a set of hypotheses, and it is based on the feature value that it has, okay? One feature, specific feature, along with the rest were question marks, right? So it is going to give you that particular set of hypotheses, okay? A categorical restriction with respect to the set of hypotheses. Hence, we call this to be as the restriction bias or the language bias. As I told, the next topic is issues in decision tree learning. When I tell issues, right, how well does decision trees really solve the problems that is being faced earlier? Okay, so when I tell avoiding overfitting the data, so we know what overfitting is, okay? So when we are trying to concise a given problem, you know, to come up with a solution, we know, okay, the data is not that more, okay? You cannot come up with some solution like this. When we still know that and we are really trying to come up something, a solution out of it, we normally call it to be as an overfitting. Right. As I told you in the previous classes, we had one example telling that if I have a set of points like this, if it is a sinusoidal curve, yes, we can draw a sinusoidal curve. If it is a straight line that has to differentiate between two, right? So it's like if you try to fix all of those points wherever you get, you know, we normally call that to be as an overfitting problem, right? Either you can just draw a single line which differentiates them into two, or we can draw a sinusoidal telling that, okay, this is, these points are actually in the sinusoidal form or a higher degree polynomial. But beyond that, to a certain extent, okay, if you're trying to come to a solution for such problems, we tell that, okay, it is overfitting the data, okay? We have to avoid such overfittings, okay? Decision trees is very one among them which actually tries to overfit the data. How does it do? And what is the definition of it, okay? Let me show you this diagram, okay? So it is telling, this is basically the size of the tree, okay? It is telling as you go around 10, 20, 30, 40, 50, okay, the size of the tree, okay, I have it. And I have the accuracy on the other end, okay. And it is showing that at one particular point on the training data, this is what its accuracy was, okay. On the testing data, okay, this is what it is showing. As the number of trees count go ahead, the accuracy was slightly decreasing, okay. So which means that, you know, whatever you come up with a solution for it is really not that suited with respect to anywhere. When even when you're training, you had that, but with the testing data, you know, because any data that you pass to it, right, it actually tells you that, no, you have actually overfitted the data. And that's the reason that you can see a dip in the accuracy levels. Okay. So how do we write this as? There's a definition that it tells you. Given a hypothesis space H, a hypothesis H, okay, small h, belongs to capital H, is said to overfit the training data, okay? It is said to overfit the training data if there exists some alternative hypothesis H dash that belongs to H such that H has a smaller error than H dash. This H, the training data's error, is smaller with respect to the testing data H dash, okay, over the training examples. But this H dash has a smaller error than H over the entire distribution of instances. Okay, if you just try to understand this logic, right, let me just give you one example. If I tell, okay, you are the topper of the university. You are the topper of the college. Okay. So I will not consider this as an error. Okay. But I'll give you as an award. Okay. You can consider the error here is an award, just a correlation to that. See, normally when we keep talking to someone, right, okay, everybody or the parent will be telling, I want you to be the best. I want you to, you score the rank one. Okay. But when you're writing your board exams, what happens? You will be the topper of your school. Okay. What is your marks? What is your marks that you have scored? Okay. The same topper of the school, you might have multiple schools with multiple toppers. If you categorize yourself to the entire set of things, okay, though you are a topper here, okay, there could be other students as well in the other colleges or other schools, you know, and when it you write your board exam, at that time is what you get your score. right? It is considered as a whole set of distribution of data.